Okay, so we'll go ahead and get started. My name is Karen Rodgers, and I am part of the learning team with Tobii Dynavox. And today we're going to talk about some Tobii Dynavox solutions that we can use to support individuals with ALS. So some of this information I'm going to give you to start is going to feel like some review, and some of them will be new information because we're going to really highlight our new iSeries device here as well. So when we know and we're working with individuals with any sort of progressive disease, such as ALS, we really recognize their communication needs, right? We need to communicate needs and wants, right? We want to communicate for social closeness and really support those roles and kind of those vocations that those communicators have, okay? We also know that we need to provide them with some continuity in some reliable software and technology that they can use to continue and maintain those roles, right? There's all sorts of different options that our communicators can use, and to provide you with a variety of those options can feel really intimidating to someone who's not very, doesn't feel very comfortable with technology, right? So the biggest thing that we really need to do is provide them with these tailored solutions to meet their needs, right? And not just a plethora of a bunch of solutions that might not that are available but might not meet their needs. So as we talk about a progressive disease and as we talk about ALS, we talk about a variety of ways to meet communication needs. And we can meet these needs through low and high tech options, right? Through writing things down, through mobile devices, right? Through some gestures, facial expressions, all right? And then we really kind of, as those diseases progress, we eventually get to that point of those high-tech needs and those high-tech devices. So specifically what we're going to be spending our time talking about in this demo session is our new iSeries device, okay? And so how can we really support some of those progressive diseases with our iSeries? So you asked, and we heard you, and came up with some really awesome ways that we can support our ALS users in our progressive disease kind of field, okay? So with our new iSeries, there's a variety of different features which really, really support our literate and progressive users. So we made our screen bigger, which really helps and kind of provides more space for our communicators, okay? So adding that inch really supports and kind of provides more of that space to work with. We added our new camera. We had a front-facing camera as well, but we kind of upgraded it and makes it for those really high-level selfies that everybody loves to take of themselves. And probably one of my favorite features of the device is that it has touch-enabled and gaze-enabled buttons. So this is huge and awesome and truly, truly helps our communicators to be more independent. So with these adaptive buttons on this left-hand side, you have a plus and a subtract button, which really it supports that volume control. So if our communicator is in a library or a quiet setting and they want to bring that volume down, or if they're in a loud conference center and they really need to boost their volume, they can control that on their own. We don't have to rely on a communication partner to do that, okay? Then over on those, we have those right-handed side buttons, right, with that triangle and that square, which are also those adaptive buttons that support our communicators. So if our communicator thinks, gosh, I'm not quite sure if the computer is reading my eyes, that's what they can use to pull up to see where their eyes are on the screen. They can use those buttons to recalibrate. If you're familiar with our old iSeries or our current i12 and i15, those buttons are on the side. However, it required a caregiver to touch those buttons for a user to recognize where they were on the screen, okay? So this kind of really helps and increases that empowerment and really provides with that increased independence. Okay. A couple other features kind of towards the back of the device. We have this partner window, which again is awesome. As we know with speech generating devices, we kind of lose that face-to-face and that eye contact that we have. However, if I'm typing on a computer, I don't always want my communication partner to guess or anticipate what I'm gonna say next, right? They can then see and I can send it to that partner window when I'm ready. There's some other features. If you are interested and want to take a deeper dive into the hardware and software, we can kind of show you over that in our booth or the learning lounge, and I can kind of show you where that is afterwards. But not to get into the weeds on this short 20-minute demo, but there's a few different features that are really, really awesome, such as kind of allowing your communication partner to know that you're speaking, right? So if you have an iPhone or if you have a mobile device and the person that you're wanting to text message, you're wanting to see if they are gonna get back to you, and you see those three dots, right? You're like, oh, they're responding. They're gonna get back to me pretty quick. That also can pop up here, right? To let them know that, hey, I'm typing something. I want you to know something. Okay, I'm gonna give you a message here in a little bit. All right? So this is such an awesome feature that increases that ability to have that face-to-face communication so our communicators don't have to sit side by side all the time. And again, we have our camera and then the power button. Sometimes things are obviously, as we know with technology, things are getting much easier. And as things get easier, apparently they get harder. So sometimes people get their devices and they think, well, how in the heck am I supposed to turn this thing on? There's no buttons on the side. There's that button on top. Okay, so again, to kind of talk about that partner window that I mentioned, that's what that looks like. So here is the new iSeries. This is the i16. And then here's that partner window on the back. Any questions? Okay. So I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna talk about some of the software that's on the device. So that's kind of the hardware part of the system as well. So here are the options of software on the device. So we have our hardware settings, we have computer control, and this mirror for Android. For communication software, we have Communicator 5 and SnapCore First. So within Communicator 5 and SnapCore First, you can launch Control. And Control is what I'm gonna talk to you about right now. So when we're talking about those independent communicators, those people who are really, really great at using technology, and even those who aren't great at using technology and want to use their same interface that they've been using in the past, they can use computer control, okay? All right, so I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna jump into this computer control. So this is really, how can I use desktop access, okay, from my iSeries device? So we really knew that we needed to provide our communicators with a way to use their current technology, right? And that we wanted to provide a way for them to be able to use their current interface and to use the tools that they have, but we needed to make it an easier way. So here's a video kind of on interaction first. So previously we had this idea of function first, with all of these buttons and controls on the side of the screen. So you would choose the function that you were looking for. And my sound isn't working. But here with computer control, we'll see if this will work. It allows you to do I look at the icon. So really what we're talking about is with the current way we use computer control, I'm gonna sneak back here. we have the buttons here first. So I had to identify what I wanted that mouse to do. So as you're using a mouse, we know if we're gonna right click, left click, if we're gonna drag and drop, right? We had to identify that function first, then go to the icon, right? And then select. Now with the new, we have where you select the icon and then you select the function, right? So that provides more of that interactive experience that makes more sense to all of us, right? All right. So gaze trace really kind of identifies, and what we really knew is people want to know that they know where they're looking on the screen, and how do I know that if I don't have any sort of feedback on the screen to tell me where I am? Okay, so we have this gaze trace, which provides us with where we're looking. So you can kind of see here that I have on the, I'm looking at the notepad here. Okay, and then I'm kind of glancing around across the screen, and I can always see where I am. Yeah. No. Mm-mm. So this is separate. This is Computer Control is separate from Communicator 5. However, you can launch Computer Control from Communicator 5, which we do have quite a few people that do that. So you can't hear my audio, so that's what's going on right now. But then the really great thing, too, that we kind of the developers talked about when they were doing this was kind of what happens with these menus. So if we talk about gaze interaction, right, and you talk about gaze selection, you're having to read the buttons at the same time as you're making a selection, which makes that pretty tricky, right? So if I go ahead and I see these menus pop up, okay, I can read what each button does, but I'm not selecting the button at the same time, right? If that makes sense to anyone, because I have those buttons, I have those explanations outside of that button, okay? So I'm not having to select at the same time and wondering if I, oh, shoot, I made the wrong decision. I need to come back and fix that, right? So it provides you with that. It also kind of provides you with that interaction method of what you're doing once you hit the screen, okay, and where you can select and what each button does. The other kind of nice feature about this is the reason and why those buttons are, a couple features are the way that they look and are designed is they're circles. That's a lot easier for our eyes to track and to select our circles of buttons rather than those typical square or straight lines, which we're used to considering when we think about eye tracking. Okay. And then as you can see, as it kind of zooms into onto that image, everything else is kind of blurred around, right? So that really helps us with that field of vision and really helps us to kind of pinpoint in on what we're looking for. Coming, I promise. So here's an example of this interaction menu. I look at the Google Chrome icon, I look, and then it's going to give me these options of what do I want to do. Do I want to drag and drop, right? Do I want to right click? Do I want to left click? And then I have the off-screen menu as well. So if the user goes ahead and looks down on their device, okay, they can select that menu, right? And then they can select what they want to do as well. If they kind of think, I'm not quite sure, okay, and then in my audio I'm telling you, if I want to pause, what do I want it to happen right here? Okay, so this eye tracking, our computer control right now is available on the i13 and i16 devices. Again, the question that people often get is you can launch it from Communicator 5 and SnapCore first. Okay, so you can be using, as a user, you can use both. And what I personally love about this, and especially in that progressive space, is my user can be working, right? They can be a CFO of this company, they can be a landscape designer, they can do whatever they want, and they can use the software that they're used to using, right? And they're able to do that interactively, okay? With also the use of their communication software in Communicator 5, in Communicator or SnapCore first, okay? Okay, so I'm just gonna kind of run you through, I just wanna show you how simple it is for a user to get started. There's a couple features in here that kind of make it really unique and awesome. So once the user gets started, truly, all they have to do is someone needs to be there to double click on that control and it pops up. From then on, the user is free to use it as independently. They're empowered to use the software as they are. Okay, so you get this welcome screen. It's gonna take you into calibration. They can calibrate themselves. They can see where they are on that track status box. And then truly to make those communicators independent. I'm gonna step back, but to be honest with you, you could probably walk up to an iSeries device and start using it. You don't need to calibrate it each time. The hardware is hardy enough that you could use somebody else's calibration probably. So you don't need to have it calibrated. You're not gonna have to calibrate all the time. Again, what you saw, that terms of service, which is awesome, because if a user, they deserve that ability to select that they understand that, right? We're providing that understanding and that empowerment that they know what they're signing up for, right? So they're the one that starts selecting that. And then they're free to go, right? And it provides you with these start guides the whole time, okay? I highly encourage you to try it out. Like I said, we have our eye trackers in our learning lounge, which it's open till 1 o'clock, and the room is Curacao 5 is the learning lounge. Otherwise, you can also go over to the booth. You can try that device out until 1 o'clock over there if you want to give it a whirl. I recommend that you give it a try. Otherwise, we're also going to do another kind of deeper dive session on computer control at 2:20. It's called A Mouse is More Than a Click, but yeah. Thanks, you guys. I hope you're as excited about this new iSeries as we are, and hope you have a great day.